Kent Babb has been a journalist and columnist for The State, the Kansas City Star, and currently the Washington Post. And his work has also been included in the Best American Sports Writing. And tonight, Kent talks about the complicated tale of Allen Iverson. Iverson, with his strengths and faults as a professional and a person, has become a Rorschach test for many American fans when it came to the subject of race and class. But Kent delves deeper than that, giving us a more complete picture of the man and his motives in life. So please welcome Kent Babb.
Well, good evening, everybody. Thanks for coming in out of the rain to see me and hang out. So my name's Kent, like he said, and I wrote about a guy named Allen Iverson who, if you don't know who he is, he's one of the most transcendent, inspiring, frustrating, great, terrible people maybe to play sports in my generation. He's a guy who, forgive the pun, crossed over into celebrity, pop culture. When I was sort of coming of age in the late 90s, people like Allen Iverson, who were the anti-heroes, that was what sort of dominated pop culture. That was the birth of Tony Soprano and Fight Club and American Beauty, things like that. To pay homage to my South Carolina roots, my pro wrestling favorite, my favorite pro wrestlers were The Rock and Stone Cold Steve Austin. But the difference was Allen Iverson was real. You know, he was a guy who didn't care what anybody said or thought. He was going to have his cornrows and his tattoos. He was going to drop F-bombs during press conferences. He didn't really care now what anybody thought about him. He was going to do him. And so a couple of years ago, I profiled Iverson for the Washington Post. It was an equal parts frustrating and interesting piece. He's a guy who doesn't really want to be written about or found. He was perfectly happy to sort of go away and kind of relish in his broken life. About that time, I started hearing about how he had somehow squandered $155 million, and that was just in playing salary. He had a nice fat Reebok contract that paid him millions more, but $155 million. I did some depressing math today. So if you make $75,000 a year, it takes you 2,000 years to make $155 million. If you're a journalist, it takes you about 10,000 years. But he made that in about 10 years and got rid of it basically in about 5 years. So how does a guy go broke if you've made $155 million over the course of 10 to 15 years thereabouts? Well, with him, it was sort of a million tiny cuts. You know, his great sin was loyalty, and he supported a lot of his friends from back home. He grew up pretty much in abject poverty on coastal Virginia in the Newport News area. And he and some friends, it was basically Iverson was the basketball player. He was the athlete, one of the best football players in the area, and also one of the best basketball players in the area. And he was going to be the representative if one of them made it in sports. A guy named Rahsaan Langford was going to be the one who, if one of them made it in music. He was a very talented rapper. And they sat around the stoop one night and said, hey, if one of us makes it, we all make it. And if I make it, I'll support the rest of you guys. If you make it, I'm riding the coattails wherever you go. And so he made good on his promise. He obviously went to Georgetown, was a star for 2 years. Maybe was the one player who kind of tamed John Thompson, changed the way he ran his basketball program, and was maybe one of the one guys who Thompson allowed to be himself. Like, he didn't try to make him into anything, which was maybe the birth of some of this stuff. But anyway, he became the number one pick in the NBA draft in 1996, and kind of away he went. And the friends from back home, they called it Crew Thick. You know, they were from Newport Bad News, and they were all going to come up together, and they were all going to enjoy the ride. And it sounds pretty awesome. His favorite place back in those days was the TGI Fridays on Mainline Avenue in Philadelphia. And I had the distinct displeasure of eating lunch there about a year ago as part of what I think was my biggest sacrifice is this research. It's really hard to find anything good to eat at the TGI Fridays. I also spent 6 grueling hours at the P.F. Chang's, which is where he likes to hang out these days too, and drink cheap beer. But back in those days when the money was flowing, so was the Corona, and he and his friend, they would keep the TGI Fridays open late. He liked to play Monopoly. So he was kind of a simple kind of guy who he was, you know, kind of newly rich, and he found a way to spend it. And he didn't buy multiple yachts or anything. He didn't spend a month in Fiji every year, but he did support, you know, upward of 35 people. And we're talking about power bills, car insurance, house payments. His mom, Iverson's mom, had two homes, eventually a restaurant. She had multiple cars. Iverson had, I think, 12 cars himself, which it's a lot of cars. I got one. So I'm going to read a little bit here. I'm not going to read an awful lot from the book, but I want to read some just to kind of give you an idea of what his lifestyle went from, which in Newport News at Hampton, he grew up in a situation where he had raw sewage coming up through the floor to the point that he had to wear Timberlands just to not feel like his feet were getting pretty messy. So he got used to kind of one type of lifestyle. Then suddenly he's just thrust into a completely different type of lifestyle, which is maybe part of a bigger conversation on how well do we prepare athletes and celebrities for this money and all that. But this is sort of toward the end. He was still very rich. As of 2009, he was making $21 million a year from the Detroit Pistons, which, you know, again, pretty nice little chunk. His wife had grown increasingly desperate to try to put a tourniquet on his spending. She went and pawned jewelry. You know, we're talking these huge. There's an 8.47 carat diamond baguette, which is probably about the size of my thumb. This giant tennis necklace, and sold all these things on consignment. And he had designed a house. This is in Atlanta, where he had sort of settled after his playing career was sort of ending. They wanted to live in Atlanta as a family. Among the features of the house were nearly 10,000 square feet, a sprawling bar, and a gourmet kitchen, and rain gutters made from pure copper. So he clearly spared no expense. I mean, they're gutters, and he made them out of copper. And so one night, and this is after his wife, Tawana, had tried to get him to stop. She'd gone to his manager, who was one of his former father figures, who became a manager, who then became one of his greatest enablers, because nobody really wanted to get off the ride. It was very fun to be around Allen Iverson during this time, so nobody really told him no. And so this is one night in Atlanta from Allen Iverson's spending. And again, this is when things were bad, you know, when people were trying to say, you need to stop spending so much. Tawana had become versed in the habit of transferring dollars, usually to pay for household expenses and paying down the thousands on her American Express card. 2 months after pawning the jewelry and the furs, she made two transfers from savings into their joint Bank of America account, one each of $60,000 and $20,000, just to cover July's bills. A few days after the transfers hit, Iverson walked into the Forever Diamonds in Atlanta and spent $20,000, part of a day of spending that included a stop at a liquor store and a hat boutique, four $200 withdrawals from a cash machine, and the first of three consecutive days at a Ruth's Chris steakhouse. A week earlier, Iverson had withdrawn $10,000 in cash, and a few days later removed a combined $7,000 in two separate stops at the ATM. Once Tawana's payments for two of the kids' private school tuition had cleared, along with the family's $15,178 mortgage payment, Iverson's shopping spree through Buckhead, near Atlanta, left too little in the account to pay the remaining bills. Tawana's rent check bounced, and so did her payment to Georgia Power, which, as a result, decreed that it would no longer accept Tawana or the family's personal checks. So, one of the richest people in sports couldn't send a check to pay his power bill. You know, that's how bad it was. And, you know, the thing I think kind of that's a larger theme here, I'm married to an accountant, Whitney's there in the back, and one of the things that she and I have talked about quite a bit is just how ill-prepared athletes are, just because they go from one end of the spectrum to the other. I mean, they go from just, I think Iverson was on the far, far end of the spectrum as far as how he grew up. But a lot of these guys grew up poor, and they see sports as their way out. This is the only way they can get out of this. And then suddenly, overnight almost, they're driving a Mercedes. You know, they have what seems like a bottomless bank account, and suddenly they can't spend it quickly enough. I mean, they want to buy mom a house. They want to buy four or five cars. And for as much, I think, that we as sort of a sports-obsessed and celebrity-obsessed culture try to get these people ready for the celebrity part of it, where they can speak eloquently and be prepared for, you know, whether it's athletics or singing or whatever. We try to get them prepared to cash in on their talent. We don't do anything or much to get them prepared for how to spend money, how to balance a checkbook, how to pay your power bill. And that was one of Iverson's problems, is that He just didn't pay for stuff. You know, it's not that he couldn't afford it. He just didn't. And, you know, a lot of the times he had people who would do it for him, people who would maybe let him go. He didn't have to do it. I mean, he ran up $25,000 at Caesar's Palace and just figured he'd walk out and not pay for it, which, you know, kind of a risky move. So there were things like that. He became so bad with money. He was a bad father, a bad husband. And I think it would be easy to say, A, why does anybody even really care about that guy? Why does anybody want him on their team? Why do you read a book about him? He's such a jerk. You know, one of the bad things he did real quick was he sort of became famous for being late, you know, sort of fashionably late. And that was part of what grew the legend, is he got to places, you know, is he going to show up? And then, oh, he's here, thank gosh. And that sort of became part of what made him cool. That was part of the rebel mentality with him. And but sometimes he no-showed pretty important events, like the birth of a second child. He got so drunk that he couldn't be roused the next morning, so he just missed the birth of his first son and second child. So why didn't people give up on him? It would be very easy to give up on somebody like that who, you know, they're on paper don't seem to be that many redeeming characteristics. Well, maybe the worst thing about Allen Iverson is that he gives you hope. And even in the course of researching and writing this book, I think I sort of got infected by the Allen Iverson virus, because I started talking to people, you know, Larry Brown, people who were with the Sixers, people at Georgetown, and I kept asking the same question. Why didn't you know, if he burned you so many times, why didn't you just distance yourself from him? And it was because there would be these small little episodes of him being such a good guy that you can't believe it. I mean, he had been tutored when he went to prison back when he was a teenager in coastal Virginia. He had been tutored by a woman who had a learning center out there just to get him eligible to come play at Georgetown. He could have easily forgotten about her. Her name was Sue Lambiot, but she got cancer, and he wrote handwritten notes to Sue's husband, talked to her all the time, just checked in on her. He could have easily said, you know what, that was part of my past, I'm a big celebrity now. But no, he remembered things like that. And later, there was a woman at Georgetown who was the sports trainer. You know, she was basically the woman who would, if somebody on the basketball team turned their ankle, she would tape it up. If you had a bruise, you know, she would take care of you. Her name is Lori Michael, and she was one of John Thompson's right-hand people. He's a very insular, you know, type of person. He runs a very insular type of program. And Lori Michael had broken through. He was his one of his consigliere's, so to speak. And so she didn't really take any grief. You know, like she would dish out tough love too. And Iverson loved that about her. He likes the fact that she didn't really deal in BS. You know, she would put it to you straight. And if you didn't like it, so what? Goodbye, get out of here. And Iverson started being curious by her. And he would go see her, check in on her. Well, sure enough, she gets diagnosed with cancer too, a brain tumor. This is a few years ago. And yet again, he decides to check in on her. He sent money. He, you know, flew her around to attend basketball games. He, you know, offered to pay for medical expenses, things like that, things he didn't have to do. And so people, I think, easily could have given up on him. And even my own experience, you know, I've been asked, especially the last couple of weeks, you know, is he a good guy or a bad guy? The way I try to construct this book is I kind of referred to it during the process of good Iverson versus bad Iverson. I mean, there are two very distinct sides of this guy. And there's a really good side to him that is loving and caring and thoughtful and, you know, one of the most amazing people you can really dream up. And there's also a really dark side to him, you know, the kind of guy who comes home super drunk, whose wife thinks he's going to walk over and give her a hug, and sure enough, he stomps down on her foot, her bare foot, and tries to acts like he's putting it out like a cigarette. And that's pretty dark, and it's just out of nowhere. He drank so much, and then somebody put it, I thought, very well. He's got a very caring soul, but he was corrupted by entitlement and alcohol. And I think that's sort of common with a lot of celebrities these days, especially athletes, just, you know, again, who don't sort of get, they don't always get from point A to point B on some of the more subtle social things. And I'll read another passage. This is toward the end of the book. This is a spoiler-free thing toward the end. But this is something that I think sort of illustrates how people cared for him and couldn't quite give up on him. This is, I chased Allen Iverson around for the better part of a year and a half trying to find him. I spent those wonderful 6 hours in P.F. Chang's where I knew that he would go and hang out and drink just for hours at a time by himself. I spent lots of time in Atlanta, in Virginia. I even went to Istanbul trying to at least get in his head a little bit and just figure out, you know, he played there a few games trying to make a few bucks. So this was actually the first time I met him face to face. I'd seen him a few times, and I wanted to give him a chance to talk. A lot of this came from interviews. I interviewed about 100 people, had about 700 pages of court records and sworn testimony, things like that, and also basically read every important story that Allen Iverson was ever a part of, and that's a lot. And so I finally saw him. This is last September. They were breaking ground on the new John Thompson Center, which is going to be the new basketball facility on campus. And I went up to him, there's a little redundancy here, so apologies. But this is about Lori Michael, the Georgetown basketball trainer. Michael had been diagnosed 3 years earlier with a brain tumor, undergoing surgery and somehow fighting off the disease. Her refusal to give up, despite the long odds, she continued to refuse doctor's offer for a prognosis, was one of the things Iverson loved about her, along with her penchant for honesty and tough love. Still, she was thin and weak, and on this morning, Iverson was her support beam. They were kind of walking up from McDonough Gymnasium, and she was more or less hanging on to Iverson. And Iverson's not a big guy, but compared to, you know, a woman who's been sick for a long time, you know, he was a nice physical support beam. And plus, I think there's some symbolism in that. But she had an arm around him, and he had an arm around her. They reached the tent's entryway, Iverson sipping bottled water and dressed neatly in a light blue dress shirt with the sleeves rolled up. He wore a thin do-rag beneath the cap, the tails of fresh braids peeking out from the bottom. It was a celebration, an optional activity that Iverson could easily have blown off. But he was here, and he looked good, no other way to put it. His eyes were clear, his speech was sharp, his posture strong. And as the group made its way through the checkpoint, Thompson, still hulking at age 73, dropped a hand on Iverson's shoulder and looked down into his eyes the way he had done nearly two decades earlier, and smiled the way a father would. Dikembe Mutombo was there, Patrick Ewing, Paul Tagliabue, some of the biggest names in sports and probably in Georgetown, sort of the Georgetown community, they were all there. And Iverson, he sort of got swallowed up in this crowd, and they got separated. Lori and Iverson got separated. And I'm trying to follow Iverson and just see as much as I can to get an idea of kind of, you know, what he's thinking, if he's hungover or drunk, or if he's, you know, what he says. And I was pleasantly surprised. Iverson was a few steps ahead of Michael, the crowd enveloping her. And when Iverson realized she was gone, he stopped and turned around. "Where Miss Michael at?" he said, his eyes scanning the faces. Then she raised her hand and smiled, getting Iverson's attention. Looking relieved, he walked back toward her and wrapped an arm around her waist. And before they took another step, she leaned toward him and kissed him on the cheek. And so to me, you know, especially having gotten into the nitty-gritty on some of the really bad stuff with Iverson, just kind of learn, I mean, there was some depressing things I had to find out, and you can look forward to reading, that are about him, just because he is sort of just as frustrating and maddening as he is inspiring. But that was such a cool moment, you know, that was something where, again, he didn't have to do that. I mean, this is one of the more famous people ever to walk the acres of Georgetown University, and he cared about this woman who he easily could have forgotten. And I just thought that was cool. And just cared enough to get her to her seat. And that's why people can't give up on him. And, you know, so when people ask me, do I think he's more good or bad, I have to think for a second, because I think he's both, for one. I think he's good and bad. I don't think it's quite as black and white as that. And the other thing is, I want him to be good. You know, I want him to be a good guy. You know, we grew up, or we watch these sort of, you know, we call them sports heroes. We grew up watching them and idolizing them and wanting to be them. And the way Iverson was, you know, he's a little guy. You know, the reason he was so popular is because he gave anybody who was not 7 feet tall or 300 pounds a little bit of hope, misplaced as it was, that maybe they could be an athlete somewhere. And so he gave people that hope. And I think, at least I can say this for myself, I want him to be, finally, I want him to be on the right side of things. I want him to not be broke. I want him to not be drunk. So that's what I mean when I say I think I got kind of infected by the Iverson virus a little bit, because I, like so many people in his life, you know, I haven't quite given up on him. And so I think he can do better. He just turned 40 a couple of weeks ago, so I mean, it's still relatively early in his life. And so I think there's time. It's just, sadly, the same thing that created Allen Iverson is the same thing that sort of destroyed him, or has destroyed him up until now, and that's that refusal to accept that there are boundaries. I mean, most of us, whatever we do, have to accept the fact that you can't drive 80 miles an hour, much as you want to. You can't, you know, drink 30 beers and still go to work the next day. You can't do certain things and still be able to function. Well, that was never Iverson's thing. He was Superman. And, you know, he didn't have to sleep. He didn't have to eat. You know, his favorite meal was two scoops of ice cream and a Sprite. You know, he crushed four hot dogs before, you know, the six-foot guard from Georgetown before he got introduced at during 76ers games. And apparently that's all the fuel a high-performance body needs. It's four hot dogs just down the hatch. I can't do it. Most of us can't. But a six-foot player like him who... He was listed at 165 pounds. He's not. Having seen him in person a lot, he's probably barely even 6 feet tall. He's a little shrimp of a guy. Had no business even making it to the NBA. He probably shouldn't have even played in Georgetown on paper. He was number one pick, became the MVP of the league, and brought a pretty bad 76ers team to the NBA Finals just on his shoulders, his very frail shoulders. And so none of those things should have happened. But he didn't pay any attention to what should have happened or what shouldn't have happened. He did it his way. And George Lynch, who's from up here, he's from Northern Virginia. He played with Iverson on that pretty weak 2001 team that got to the finals and eventually got beat by the Lakers, but they still won a game. But he put it to me, I thought, a really good way. Iverson, who was so small, especially on these playgrounds out in Hampton, he probably had to survive out there, which some of these places are really competitive. D.C.'s kind of like this, too, as far as basketball, and it used to be even more competitive than it is now. But out there, Iverson had to be a certain way just to survive. And to make it to where he got to, he had to do it his way. And that was probably his downfall. And George Lynch told me that. And that really sort of struck a chord with me, because if you get used to that for years, and that's how you become successful... How do you save yourself? You know, if people are saying, hey, Allen, you don't need to drink so much today. You don't have to spend so much money today. You don't have to go to Atlantic City tonight and drop 30 grand on the blackjack table. You can stay home and watch TV like the rest of us. No, I mean, that's just not how he did it. So this refusal to accept reality was inspiring. And, I mean, it pushed him to the NBA mountaintop and made him one of the most famous celebrity or famous sports stars in America during that time. But then the game stopped. And so I tried to write this story, and forgive the cheese, I guess, but I tried to write it sort of as a love story, because Allen Iverson, this is a sports book, I'm aware. But he had two great loves in his life. One was Tawana, his high school sweetheart, and the other was basketball, because that was part of his identity. And again, I think, you know, and I won't pontificate too much about what, you know, maybe the overuse of sports as identity or whatever. But when those two things, when those two loves went away, he wasn't able to recover. And especially basketball, I think. I mean, because I think for a long time, you know, he maybe took his family for granted. But basketball was the one thing, I think, sort of holding his life together. Because you could overlook if he was drunk the night before, if he still came out and dropped 40 on the Kings or the Suns or whoever. If he could do that, who cared how he spent the night before? You know, and sort of the reason I think that sports are great but also a little dangerous sometimes is we don't pay much attention to what happens after the lights go off. You know, I remember as a, you know, when I was a kid and I hoped to become a journalist someday, I thought I wanted to be a baseball writer, which that would have been crazy, but back then, I thought, well, all you got to do is show up at 7 o'clock and cover the game, write it, and get out of there at 10 o'clock. Then you're done. That's a great way to spend the day. It's not quite like that. I've come to learn. There's a lot more that goes into it. And I learned that people like Iverson, he was one of those who actually could show up and just play. He would show up 19 minutes before a game sometime, you know, throw his clothes on, make plans to go to TGI Fridays or maybe the strip club later that night. You know, and just in time, that's when he would crush the four hot dogs, and just in time for the announcements, go running onto the court, and he would do great. And people just said, okay, well, I guess that's just Allen. Michael Jordan could do that. Magic Johnson could do that. Not very many people can do that. Sort of the best, the elite could do that. And Allen Iverson was one of those guys. But once basketball, his great love, as I put it, sort of went away, he was lost. You know, he didn't listen to coaches. He didn't really listen to teammates. He did it his way. And, you know, so that I think was tough on him because, you know, he didn't have that one thing to kind of keep him in line. And so I think that was a difficulty for him big time. And it got to a point where this little guy who had been sort of surrounded by noise and people for most of his life. I mean, let's face it, we like celebrities in this culture. We gravitate to the people who are on magazine covers, who are on TV, things like that. We, for some reason, like that, maybe too much. Iverson was never alone, and he got used to that, and he got used to paying for everything. Like, I interviewed a rapper, Jadakiss, for this book, and he used to party with him on South Beach. And Jadakiss was a rapper. I mean, I'm sorry, was a millionaire and probably still is a millionaire, because every time when they would drink for 8 hours, and we're not talking cheap stuff here, the bill would come and Iverson would take care of it. $30,000, I got this. $25,000, I got this. Every time. And which I'm sure was great if you're Jadakiss or somebody hanging with them, but if you're Iverson, you deplete that just over and over. So somehow $155 million just goes away over the course of 15 years. And it's hard for me to fathom. And I joke, I make light of this sometimes and say, I wish I had the chance to blow $155 million. I think it'd be a lot of fun, but maybe not, because I sort of see what happens after the fact. So with him, I think once the games went off, he was no longer on TV. He was sort of, I think, exposed for, you know, being this person who just, it prematurely ended his career too, because he wouldn't conform. He, you know, at the time, this gets a little inside basketball-y, I guess, but he didn't want to come off the bench. He was a star, and he saw himself only as the MVP. That's the only way he could see it, and so he went to Detroit. He left Philadelphia. They basically gave up on him in 2006 because he was such a pain in the ass. Just, they wanted nothing to do with him. They took everything that had his picture on it, had his name on it, took it out of the arena, traded him to Denver. He was okay there. By the time he went to Detroit and then Memphis, and he eventually made his way back to Philadelphia, but things were so bad that teams just didn't want anything to do with him. He was toxic, and people kept their distance. Teammates didn't. They sort of lost this fascination with Allen Iverson. And two, he couldn't play anymore. I mean, he couldn't do what he once could. And so very suddenly, he went from being the most famous person in a 20,000-seat arena, you know, cupping his hand around his ear like that and people chanting MVP, to suddenly he's by himself. You know, these two great loves, basketball and his wife, who eventually left him after, you know, a lot of craziness. And I'll talk about the infamous Reebok Trust in a minute. She essentially had him sign a postnuptial agreement, which, depending on how you look at it, is either very smart and Machiavellian, or, you know, kind of a way to empty the last of his bank account, which is what he believed. I mean, again, they were high school sweethearts, so it's both those things, I think, you know, can be debated. But we're talking, Reebok set aside $32 million that he can't touch. He was spending so much money that they set aside $32 million that he wouldn't be able to touch until he turned 55, just kind of hoping that he would have a little bit for a rainy day. Well, sure enough, in a moment of desperation, when his wife was threatening to leave him and take all five kids and move someplace else, and sorry, Alan, you're by yourself, she presented him with this just excruciatingly one-sided postnuptial agreement. He had presented her with a prenup before they got married back in 2001, and he couldn't bring himself to even give it to her, so he pulled it out of his pocket, pretended to give it to her, and then he lit it on fire, which is very sweet, but, you know, maybe not so smart. And so he signed this postnup. Sure enough, it was sort of littered with very easy tripwires, things like you can't stay out past midnight, you can't gamble ever, things like that, which that would have constituted a cold turkey personality change for Allen Iverson. Just wasn't going to happen. Just, that was never going to happen with him. And so a couple of months after he signed this thing, off she goes. You know, is now spending, I think her monthly rent was like $12,000, so it wasn't like she was living cheap. But that was their new normal. She had grown up kind of modestly, too, in Virginia. And so This is sort of at the beginning of the book, and one of the things that really struck me was how he responded to the silence. Sort of, and so a life addicted to noise and stimulation gone quiet. And so 3 or 4 nights a week, he drove to the Cumberland Mall in Northwest Atlanta, parking on the shopping center's north side. And let me tell you, this is a pretty depressing place. You know, I went there. This is about almost a year ago. It's a mall. I mean, it's beginning to kind of deteriorate. A lot of the stores have moved out, but there's this P.F. Chang's there that he for some reason loved. He walked past the fountain, through the revolving door at P.F. Chang's, and past the host station. Along either side of the aisle were tables with families and laughing friends, and straight ahead was the crescent-shaped bar, where a pair of televisions were usually tuned to sports highlights. Comfort waited only a few strides away. Sometimes diners recognized him, and Iverson occasionally smiled as a stranger snapped a photograph. Other times he wore a floppy hat and sunglasses, taking his normal seat and ordering the night's first Corona, his eyes finding highlights that no longer included him, tipping the clear glass bottle upward and trying like hell to hide from an almost unsympathetic world. So it was a very tough transition for him. The Reebok Trust has gotten quite a bit of attention, whether or not he was drunk during the practice rant has gotten quite a bit of attention. That's been a lot of fun the last few weeks. But he was a guy who just didn't pay attention to social norms and things like that, which I think is great, but also terrible. And so the thing that I did hope to kind of present here is, and I touched on this before, but I think a lot of times, especially in sports, you either win or you lose. You're either good or you're not. You're either, you know, whatever, you're on this team or that team. It's always black and white, and I think that's part of the reason we like sports so much, because it's simple. But Allen Iverson's not a simple guy. Is he good or bad? Well, he's both of those things. He's inspiring, but he's also, you know, somebody you can't really stand to look at too long. He's frustrating, and he's also, you know, amazing. He's, you know, a great, loyal person who maybe that's his worst sin. But he's also a terrible father and husband, things like that. So he's a guy who does all of those things and just didn't, he only wanted to do it his way. And I think that's, as George Lentz said, that's what made him and what broke him too. So I may be finishing a little bit early here, but I'd be happy to take a few questions from you.
Time for a few questions. Just make your way to one of these two microphones. Thanks.
Reference to the, like, what makes a very good... Oh, God, I thought I turned you off. What makes a good athlete doesn't necessarily make a good person, because they have to be centered on one thing, and that's pretty much what he was.
Well, that's sort of the thing is, in you know, the last few weeks, I've had to deal with the Allen Iverson and Stephen A. Smith mafia, just because I think for good reason, Iverson has his fans, and... You know, they're very protective of his image, and you know, somebody like me who I don't know Allen Iverson, I'm just a dumb journalist who tried to get to know him as best I could. I would have loved to have talked to him, but I think that's one thing that I think is tough for a lot of people, because sports are a nice escape, and you don't have to think too much to enjoy the games. I like that too. I mean, I don't want to sound pretentious or arrogant, because that's one of the reasons I love sports. I like to turn my brain off and just see who wins. But too many times we look at these people as heroes just because they can hit a ball a long way, or they can catch a ball or throw it or dribble, you know, have the best crossover in the NBA. And it's just not that simple. And I think that's okay. You know, I think it's okay to ask those questions if, you know, if an athlete like a politician or an actor, whoever, maybe they're good at their job, but they're terrible elsewhere. Maybe they can get better over here. And maybe it's worth pointing out that he just pushed everything into being the best basketball player he could possibly be and didn't have time to be a good guy. I don't know. I think he probably could have been a little bit better guy. But I definitely do not think that being a great athlete makes you a great person. And I, you know, so I'm a sports writer, and I used to care more about the sports than I did the writing. And as I get older, I care more about the writing than I do the sports, and I get more interested in the people who are behind it. So this is not a book about, you know, that involves that many sports highlights. Some of the more famous moments are included in here, but I try to give context to what led to that. You know, the practice rant, for instance, the crossover of Tyronn Lue during the NBA Finals. when he crossed over Michael Jordan, things like that. I want to tell you how those things happened. But I really wanted to get into who he is as a person, not just a player, because I don't really read sports books for that very reason, because I don't really care why they're so good at, like, you know, at being good athletically. I just don't care that much. To me, that's simple, and I like to watch that during the games, and that's it.
Well, the other thing that a lot of people don't realize is that their careers, or any sports person's career, is finite. And managing finances, when you got all these people hanging around you supposed to be helping you and actually are emptying you, like I said before, you know, they empty your pocketbook and then you end up with nothing.
Well, and that's the thing is...
Their manager or like their agent should be the one saying, hey, look.
Well, and in fairness, I guess, people who were around Allen Iverson did try. And, you know, so his first agent was David Falk, who was famously Michael Jordan's agent. And so there was a lockout year. I believe this was 1998. Yeah. And Falk approached Iverson and said, hey, you know, you don't need to be spending so much money. Just, you may not get paid this year. How about save a little bit of that? And so because Falk had the audacity to bring that up, he fired him. So Iverson fired him for that. And so he put two attorneys back home in charge of his finances. And so sure enough, they were sort of responsible for that Reebok trust, sort of putting money aside. And at one point, they said, you're spending way too much money. You got to stop this. Look, you're going to be broke one day. So he stripped financial responsibilities from them and gave it to his wife, who he knew he was able to kind of run over and control. So it's not that people didn't try. It's just it's very easy in this universe to be surrounded by yes men and enablers, and that's a very comfortable place to be. And I think that it got to a point where people just didn't want to jack with their place in the movie theater. They wanted to be right there with it and, you know, drinking for free and having a great time and on the private jets and going to Brazil. They didn't want to mess with that. And I kind of get that, but it's probably not being the best friend in the world.
Yeah.
We have another question over here. Okay. This is a two-part question. One, when interviewing the people that you did get in contact with about Iverson, was the, like, dualism that you're talking about how he's a good guy and a great guy kind of evident to everybody, or did some people just see him one way or some people saw him the other way? And the second thing is, do you feel like, as you know, in the sports world, that you were kind of, because you wanted to interview such a high-profile character in the NBA, that the NBA people, and like you said, ESPN, Stephen A. Smith, and his fans kind of like rebuffed you a lot?
Oh, yeah. What was the first part again? I'm sorry,
like,
I got a short attention span.
When you were interviewing people for the book and like finding more about his history.
Oh, right.
What was the dualism?
I feel like people were kind of on one side or the other, maybe not entirely. Like, so Larry Brown is a good example, and Larry Brown is the coach who famously, they went to war. I may have to have you repeat the second part too, but you can take a seat. But they did great things together, but they kind of hated each other. I mean, they were on completely opposite sides of the spectrum. One was a young African-American athlete from the streets. The other was an old Jewish white coach who really couldn't. He didn't know how to talk to Iverson. Iverson didn't know how to talk to him. So they butted heads. They both wanted the same thing. But now you look at it, and Brown says he was put on this earth to coach Allen Iverson, which is crazy because he won an NBA championship and he won a college basketball championship at Kansas. And his greatest accomplishment was coaching this giant pain in the ass. And which, I mean, I guess I understand people that want a challenge and things like that. But I'm sorry, to answer your question, people like him, he wants to see only the good in Iverson. And Aaron McKee, who was a very close friend and teammate of Iverson, sort of the same thing. When I would bring up some of the bad stuff, was he drinking too much? Yeah, but it was funny to us. And, well, you know, what about him as a husband? Well, we never thought it was that bad. So things like that. And part of that, I think, is sort of the sports mentality. You don't really bring stuff at home into the locker room and all that. But the people, like, if you don't like Iverson, you really don't like him. If you do like Iverson, you love him. And you want him to be saved and things like that. So usually when I would interview somebody, and like I said, it was about 100 people, and I usually knew where I stood, like what the conversation was going to be like when I started it, because I generally knew kind of what people thought of them going in. And what was the second part again?
Do you feel like, you know, like you said, had issues with like Skip Bayless coming?
All right.
And do you feel like the NBA and like the fans of Iverson, like his image,
his part in like the NBA changing, and how they kind of rebuffed you for trying to, I guess, open this can of worms?
I think it's just a matter of people who aren't interested in knowing more than what they see on TV are not going to be interested in a book like this. So that's not my target audience, and that's okay. And I've had to kind of get used to that. Nobody likes being called, bad names on Twitter. Nobody likes that. I guess I've been a little surprised and maybe disappointed that many people, like, I'm not a big ESPN and ESPN First Take fan. It's just not my thing. It's a sort of empty calorie journalism, if you can even call it that. It's entertainment and it's, I don't know. But my new friend, Stephen A. Smith, did not, for one, he wasn't even in the room that day, so he can't say that Iverson was drunk during the press conference, even more than I can say that he was, and neither of us gave him a blood test. I know that in the point I was trying to make, I never actually write in this book, this is, an annoyance of mine, I never actually write in this book that he was definitively drunk. I say that people who were in the Sixers organization, Larry Brown, Billy King, teammates, just about everybody in that room thought he had been drinking that day, which, the point is, he was drinking so much in that time that maybe his most famous moment, he had alcohol on his breath. And so, I've done some radio shows, and a lot of the folks who, clearly haven't read the book, maybe, I don't know, maybe it's asking too much for people to read the book before they interview me, but they ask me, well, Iverson says he wasn't drunk during that. Well, no, he didn't. Stephen A. Smith said he wasn't drunk. And yes, I understand he supposedly talked to Iverson, but, I wish Iverson had talked to me directly. Whatever. I mean, he probably has nothing to gain from talking to me. I can understand that. And B, I wish Stephen A. Smith had voiced those concerns to me directly instead of declining my interview request about a year ago. So I tried to interview Stephen A., definitely tried to interview AI, instead of hearing about it on First Take and kind of having to deal with the Twitter mafia. So those people cannot be convinced of my point of view, and I don't think I can be convinced of their point of view that Iverson is good and he's okay and he's awesome, and so that's it.
Thank you for coming. First off, Skip Bayless and Stephen A. Smith, they're sort of pathetic, all that whole brand of, except for PTI pretty much, all those types of shows are pretty much pathetic. I just wanted to your opinion on the future for Allen Iverson. You said it yourself, he just turned 40. Do you think he's going to be able to get out of this, or is this sort of like just going to be a long, sad goodbye? Is he just going to fade away, or is he going to be able to turn around? And you mentioned the Reebok Trust. I'm sorry if you answered this earlier in your talk. Is that money going to be there for him, or is that been sort of, or is that money gone too?
So two pretty complicated questions, which I can appreciate because this is a complicated dude. But so can he be saved? I hope he can, because like I said, I grew up admiring him and really like what he could do, and I was a fan. So there's that. So I've kind of put it like I hope he's got one more great comeback in him. He has a lot of muscle memory of doing things a certain way, and that way is bad. And so he went on Good Morning America right before the Showtime documentary a few weeks ago, and they asked him, and this is all, a lot of that's on the heels of what was coming out here, because they knew. And they were asking him, we hear that you're having money problems. We hear that your marriage is you're divorced and all this. Where do you stand on this? They were asking for clarity. And so he says, maybe I'm reading too much into it, but he says, I'm good in every part of my life. And I had a problem with that because, to me, that shows just more of the denial. Because I think in his personal life, the denial is kind of what's made him, it's put him in this situation. And so I didn't like hearing that because that makes me think, though, things have gotten better. And this is going to dovetail into the second part of your question. He is at least back on friendly terms with his ex-wife. I mean, they had about as messy a divorce as you could possibly have. And look, just to be clear, he does love his wife and kids. I mean, that's not in dispute. And again, I think that's part of what's so frustrating about him is he isn't just a jerk. He does really love his family. He's just not, he doesn't come through. And so every time you think that he will, he is a no-show. And so, but I'm told that he's back on decent terms. He lives in Miami full-time and she still lives in Atlanta. And it's a situation where they've always had a complicated situation. But when he's in Atlanta, they stay together and they're on decent terms. And I guess that's great because I think they're always going to have kind of an on again, off again situation. Marriage is complicated, God knows. But with him, so as far as the money goes, he signed away at least half of that $32 million, possibly $100 million. Somebody who's extremely close to Iverson told me it was at least half. I've sort of gotten some mixed messages. Somebody said it was all. But the point is, and this is where it's really going to test him, is if he can be a good guy to his wife, he'll get all that money. But if he's not, and he, you know, makes her mad and cheats on her and gets drunk and does crazy things, then she's going to kick him out and she's going to keep all that. So his wife controls so much of his money that, you know, it certainly benefits him to be on his best behavior forever. And if he had no other incentive, it would be that. And I'd kind of write in here that he's an incentive-based organism. You know, if you dangle something in front of his head, he'll go get it. And so with him, I think it's possible, but he really needs somebody in his life to tell him no and to tell him to grow up. He's the oldest 12-year-old maybe in America. He's never had to grow up, and that's not excusing him. It's just a fact. And he just doesn't know how to do stuff. And, like, he didn't know where his kids went to school, for instance. And, you know, it's just very basic things he didn't know how to do. He just needs somebody to not BS him. You know, the money's gone for the most part. And, you know, at least the earning is gone. And the fame is largely gone. So be a good friend, you know, like, be honest with them. You know, people who've been in his corner for a long time, I think that's the best thing to do. But that's just me.
Thank you.
Thank you.
Hi. Thanks for coming. I just wanted to add, you know, you talked a lot about kind of this dichotomy of his personality, that the same kind of ethos that made him at under 6 feet become a great basketball player was probably the same thing that drove him to do some pretty bad things in his social life, but also maybe not take the best care of himself. Do you think that it would have been possible for him to have a career where he, I'm guessing the 4 hot dog diet wasn't recommended by trainers, you know, was it always going to be hot and fast? Was it always going to be the kind of thing where whatever drove him to, you know, not be stopped by his physical limitations was also going to end his career because he wasn't taking care of himself?
I think he only became the Allen Iverson that we know because he went 150 miles an hour all the time. And, like, just a quick little anecdote that I liked. I got a kick out of this. When he won the MVP in 2001, one of the things he credited was he quit Doritos. He stopped eating Doritos. He didn't really work out that much. He was like, well, I'm going to give up Doritos, which, you know, Doritos are delicious. But, you know, so he gave those up. You know, he ate fewer Snickers bars, things like that. And, you know, but that wasn't like a treat for him. Like, that was his meal. And so, I mean, he would, like, polish off a bag of Doritos in the hotel or whatever and whatever, you know, okay. But somebody asked me a week or two ago if he would have had a better career if maybe he wasn't as full tilt. But I don't think he would have been that transcendent star. Like, I think he would have been, and I can't think of somebody who comes to mind right now, but I think he would have been, maybe he would have been in the league for 15 years. You know, maybe he would have been a guy who, you know, maybe he would have been Paul Pierce. I don't know. Like,
I think about Ray Allen a lot, who is the same
yeah, kind of the same yeah. type of player. I mean, maybe he would have been Ray Allen, a guy who, you know, is well known and a good player, maybe won a couple of championships, but didn't change how we look at a player. I mean, Allen Iverson is one of the most famous people of that time. I mean, not one of the most famous athletes, one of the most famous people. And I don't think he would have come to that had he not gone and done it his way. I just don't. And so which is better? I don't know. Like, I don't know. I mean, do you want to transcend and also be a stick of dynamite, or do you want to stick around and have a healthier life? I don't know. I mean, but probably the latter now, but, you know, it's easy for me to say that.
Thank you for coming. What is his relationship like with John Thompson Jr.? How often does he speak to him?
That's the one person that I think has forever had had ultimate authority over Iverson. For one, he, you know, the way Iverson puts it is he saved his life. So when Iverson was sitting in a jail cell, you know, it's been very well documented, including here, that he was in prison. Basically, Hampton, Virginia tore itself apart because of this infamous bowling alley incident. A very complicated and convoluted situation could have made it so Allen Iverson never played college basketball, certainly not in the NBA, because he was sentenced to a quite a long prison sentence. He eventually got clemency, but nobody wanted him. You know, nobody wanted him on their team. Mike Krzyzewski at Duke said, "Nah, we don't want him." he was going to go to Maryland, so like this is not just home cooking, but he was going to be a Terp because he wanted to go play with Joe Smith, who he played with in AAU, and Gary Williams was like, "Can't have a guy like that on my team." You know, like they can't bring those questions into the team, and so that never materialized. So he was looking at having to go to Hampton University, and then suddenly Allen Iverson's mom drove up here as sort of a Hail Mary, met with John Thompson, begged him to save her child's life. He said okay. And there's some really, I think, fun, like I think Thompson's one of the best characters in this book, just because, you know, he's hilarious and intimidating, but also like a teddy bear. He said he didn't want any jackasses on his team, and like got right in Iverson's face. Was like, "Are you a jackass? Are you gonna be a jackass on my team?" And you know, Iverson just sort of wilted under Thompson's enormity. Was like, "No," and so he was the one guy who consistently got through to Iverson. I mean, there was never the hot and cold stuff that Iverson went through with Larry Brown, with all these other coaches. He had ultimate respect for John Thompson, still loves him like a father. I've put it like, I think that John Thompson is the closest thing that Allen Iverson ever had to a dad. You know, just a straight up dad who unconditionally loved him, changed everything for him, made him comfortable, things like that. And didn't, asked him to win games for him, but, you know, he wouldn't do that anyway. So when Iverson went to the NBA and Larry Brown took the Sixers job, David Falk, the agent I was talking about, who represented Michael Jordan and Iverson at the time, who got fired, he went to Larry Brown and was like, "Look," because he represented John Thompson as well. And so you have to get in Iverson's face like Thompson did. You know, you have to. This is the only way. He speaks a different language. He's from the street. He's not one of these guys who you can be like, "Hey, Allen, do you mind practicing today, please?" That was never going to be him. You have to tell him, "This is what you're going to do, or I'm going to kick your ass." And that's what Thompson did. And so Larry Brown just couldn't do it, and so, you know, that led to them butting heads forever and a pretty toxic relationship. But that never was an issue with Thompson because, A, I think Iverson was scared of him, which I get, because he's 6'10", has like a size 14 shoe. You don't want to mess with him. And two, he sees it as he saved his life. So he never messed with that relationship. And even to this day, you know, Thompson is super protective of Iverson. Told me to go F myself when I tried to interview him for this book, just because he don't want to get into that. And Iverson, he would never defy him.
Well, I think we'll have to stop there. But Ken, okay, Thank you so much for your talk. And books are for sale right up front. And thank you very much for coming.
Thanks for coming out, guys. I appreciate it very much.